With great power comes great. Anybody know? Responsibility. I have a few comic book nerds. All right. Wonderful. That line, with great power comes great responsibility, is of course from The Amazing Spider-Man. Words either attributed to the narrator of the comic book or later sometimes to Uncle Ben himself. Those are some of the best words, the best line in all of comic history and superhero history, as far as I'm concerned. I thought it would be fun then this summer if we spent some time looking at some of our favorite comic books and superheroes and what they might have to tell us about the way we live our faith. I got this idea from a book called Marvelous Myths. It's written by Russ Dalton, who happened to be my Christian education professor in seminary at Bright Divinity School. Loved classes with him. And don't worry, that was written since my graduation. Thus, it contains things like movies, the superhero movies. But we're going to start then with The Amazing Spider-Man. What I find so interesting about Spider-Man is, and specifically that line that has become so associated with Spider-Man, is that one of the reasons that Spider-Man is so popular is that he's so relatable and ordinary. This great power and great responsibility has kind of a gravitas that you don't exactly see when you look at the character of Spider-Man or know his backstory. Spider-Man, after all, is an ordinary teenager. His backstory, you know, is that he's a regular old teenager with kind of a sad childhood. His parents died when he was a baby. He's raised by this aunt and uncle, May, Aunt May and Uncle Ben. And little Peter Parker is not a popular kid in school. He's a nerd, he's a wallflower. He has trouble, you know, making friends and has all kinds of other everyday normal teenager challenges. And one day, he is in the science hall, because he's a nerd, and he's watching this exhibition, and it's an exhibit on an experiment featuring radioactivity. Now, keep in mind, this comic came out in 1962. So that was a pretty newfangled thing and a popular topic. Well, what happens, in short, is that this random tiny spider drops on his little web just in the wrong place at the wrong time and gets hit by a radioactive beam. And then, as his little eight-legged body is being overexposed to radiation of who knows what kind, he panics and he lands on Peter and bites Peter right before he dies. And Peter then develops, from this radioactive spider bite, some impressive abilities. He has superhuman strength and agility. He can suddenly climb walls and has this sort of early warning sense of danger they call spider sense or spidey sense later on in the movie. He ends up, again, being a nerdy. He creates some little web shooters for his hands, so now he can swing around and attach to things and grab things with his web shooter hands. But despite this, like, crazy coincidence stuff, Peter is a totally average teenager about it. Because the first thing, when he discovers he has these powers, the first thing on his mind is not, how can I use these to save the world? He's an ordinary teenager. Think back. What do you think the first thing on his mind is? How can I use these to make money? Of course. He just wants to make himself famous and get some money. That's what all teenagers do, right? I mean, not with, you know, superhuman abilities and stuff, usually. But he does. He goes on TV, in fact, and he is doing, you know, what amounts to party tricks, I suppose. And one day after filming in this studio, a police chase happens to go right through the studio, and Peter does absolutely nothing. Just watches it happen. And the thief gets away. The police officer is angry at Peter. Well, Spider-Man, he's in costume still. And so he's like, why didn't you do anything? Why didn't you stop him? And Spider-Man says, well, that's not my job, that's yours. I don't have to do anything anybody doesn't that I don't want to do. I don't have to do anything anybody tells me. I just take care of number one. And so he walks away, and a few days later, he comes home and sees that his house has been robbed and his Uncle Ben has been killed. And so now he cares about crime and he goes after the bad guy and, long story short, catches him to reveal that it is the same thief from the studio that he didn't do anything about. And immediately he feels guilty. He feels terrible that he could have prevented this if he had just tripped the guy, just stopped him somehow. But he did nothing. And he's devastated. And at the end of that first comic, it includes that line that he learns, with great power comes great responsibility. Well, the comic book was so popular that they gave him his own series. So then the Amazing Spider-Man comic book series, it gets its own issues. It comes out starting in 1963. But this is really groundbreaking for the comic book world, specifically the superhero genre. Because superheroes are by definition not ordinary people. They are extraordinary, and they save the day, and bad things don't happen. You know, they fix things. When this superhero genre first emerged in the 40s, it was all about Superman. You know, he was kind of the original. And he's practically invincible. He's impervious to anything except kryptonite, which is not exactly like something that you're going to run into on a frequent basis. So, for all intents and purposes, he can pretty much do and fix anything. Well, so the public is used to that being the ideal superhero. And then this comic book comes out with a nerdy teenager who doesn't even originally use his powers for good, but even after he has powers, his life does not become smooth sailing. He continues to struggle, to have, well, all kinds of ordinary teenager problems. You know, he worries about his love life, his grades in school. He's always late for things. He does and has ordinary things happen to him, like he breaks his arm and he catches a cold and has to go see a psychiatrist because he thinks he's losing his mind. I mean, just ordinary human things. And this was quite shocking for this genre, this superhero image. How can he be just a regular kid, a regular person? Don't superheroes have to be always super? See, we kind of have the same assumptions about life. You're either born wonderful and great and talented and destined for awesomeness, or you're just one of us regular people. And yet, our faith tells us, and the Bible tells us, that that's exactly the kind of people that God calls and uses. Regular, ordinary people. Not just superhumans, people with special gifts and abilities. But in fact, God has a habit of calling on and using the really, really average, sometimes the less than average, the least that you would expect, the last person that you could see saving the world, becoming a king, you know, a goofy little shepherd boy who talks to himself, or people who were fishermen, not dynamic public speakers, spread the good news of this Messiah throughout the world. God uses regular people. The Apostle Paul reminds us of that in the first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 1, beginning verse 26. The apostle says, look at your situation when you were called, brothers and sisters, by ordinary human standards. Not many were wise. Not many were powerful. Not many were from the upper class. But God chose what the world considers foolish to shame the wise. God chose what the world considers weak to shame the strong. And God chose what the world considers low class and low life, what is considered to be nothing, to reduce what is considered to be something to nothing. So no human being can brag in God's presence. It is because of God that you are in Christ Jesus. He became wisdom from God for us. This means that he made us righteous and holy, and he delivered us. This is consistent with what was written. The one who brags should brag in the Lord. Let us hear what the Spirit is speaking to God's people. The disciples are not exactly the people you would imagine who were born for greatness. Everyday people with everyday jobs, with not even particularly skilled jobs, not educated people necessarily, just ordinary people living their lives in this kind of backwater place of Galilee, not exactly the place that superheroes come from, not where rich and important people come from. And yet, it is these disciples who Jesus chooses and uses to change the world. It is ordinary people who God chooses to call, to equip, and to change the world. I've often wondered why God called me. If you'd known me as a kid or in high school, you'd probably think a lot the same about me as you would about Peter Parker. Just a nerdy kid, not that popular, and not really all that special. I've wondered before why God didn't choose my brother. That would have made more sense to me. See, my younger brother was popular, and people just wanted to follow him, and he didn't even try. In fact, he didn't necessarily even want them to follow him. He was oblivious to it most of the time, but kids just wanted to hang out with him, wanted to do what he did. I thought, God, wouldn't it have been a little easier? Like, you could have just taken him, and everybody would have wanted to hear whatever he said anyway. And I don't know, that would have made more sense to me. Brent's a natural born leader. It makes him quite good at what he does now, which is a lieutenant colonel in the Marine Corps. But why me? I didn't think I had anything special. I was not a dynamic speaker. I was not particularly comfortable in front of people. I didn't think God had given me anything to say. And yet, here I am, 15 years later or more, and God chose me, the unlikely, I guess, to share people's lives, to share what I know, to point people to Jesus. That's just such a God thing to do, to use the unexpected candidate, the unlikely. So you would expect then, once Peter got his powers, once a superhero is granted their super abilities, that life would be easier, would be good. Things would, you know, turn around for them. But as I said, that's not exactly how it happened for Peter Parker. And that's not exactly how it happened for me either, or for a lot of us who follow Christ. Sometimes we think that if we do the right things, if we answer God's call and live this certain way, that things will turn out all right, that things will go well for us. And sometimes they do. But we also know that sometimes they don't. And that even people we hold up as ideals of faith, people who did everything that God asked them to do, who made great sacrifices, who did good things, they didn't always have easy lives either. Things did not always go perfectly well for them. Jesus warned his followers about that specifically. he said that you will be a target, that it will be difficult, there will be challenges, but that God will be with you, and it will be worth it. Likewise, Peter learns over the course of his character development that this power that he's been given carries with it responsibility, and that he needs to do what is right, not just for his own benefit, but for others. And not just others he cares about, like Aunt May, but also that sometimes he has to do what is right for the bigger picture, for the greater amount of people, even if it means maybe leaving out or sacrificing time with one that he loves or is close to. The June 1973 issue of The Amazing Spider-Man, number 121, was one of the most shocking and controversial comics in history, because that's the episode, that's the comic where Peter Parker's girlfriend, Gwen Stacy, is killed by the villain Green Goblin. What? The superhero couldn't save his own girlfriend? What are you talking about? In the superhero genre, that's the formula. The superhero saves the day. Like, that's kind of how this whole thing is supposed to go. And people wondered, what is being a superhero if you can't even save the day? What good is Peter Parker? What good is Spider-Man if he couldn't even save Gwen Stacy? It was a shocking turn in the history of Marvel Comics. Some people say that it introduced kind of a less innocent era. I think 1973 could probably be fairly described as toward the beginning of a less innocent era. It was a heavy time. And what that said, what that event, that comic book not super ending, said to people was that being a superhero isn't everything. It doesn't automatically fix everything. Bad things can still happen. Superheroes are still human. And I think that reflected some level of spiritual maturity, even with that, even being a Christian, even trying to do everything right, even following closely your walk with Jesus, things can still go wrong. Bad things can still happen. You can still lose loved ones. There's still war. So why? The question that Peter would wrestle with then is, why keep going? Why continue doing superhero things? Why keep up with this great responsibility if it doesn't ultimately everything, if he doesn't always get to save the day? And I think it's a fair question for Christians as well. And the apostle speaks to that in Galatians chapter 6. In this final chapter of the letter to the church at Galatia, Paul says, Make no mistake, God is not mocked. A person will harvest what they plant. Those who plant only for their own benefit will harvest devastation from their selfishness. But those who plant for the benefit of the Spirit will harvest eternal life from the Spirit. So let's not get tired of doing good, because in time, we'll have a harvest if we don't give up. So then, let's work for the good of all whenever we have an opportunity, and especially for those in the household of faith. So let's not get tired of doing good. Let's plant for the harvest of the Spirit, for the benefit of the Spirit. Because even if we do not immediately reap the benefit, even if the harvest doesn't go our way right now, we know that the Spirit is in charge and it will. That good will win, that love will conquer all in the end. We may not get to see it. It may not work out the way we want it to, but it is worth it. Because even if we are not given great power, ordinary power will do. God gives us what we need for the tasks to which we're called. And so even ordinary power comes with responsibility. And ordinary power will be enough. Ordinary responsibility is still sufficient for God's good work to prevail. Thank you so much for being here in worship with us today, whether in person or with us online. We are glad that you're here. And we want you to know that we are here for you wherever you are in your journey of faith. If you are feeling prompted this morning to take the next step, whether that next step for you is accepting Christ or giving your life to Christ for the first time, whether it's reaffirming your faith, whether it's rededicating your life to Christ, or whether it's finding a new community to be a part of that will help you grow in your faith, we would be honored and delighted to celebrate that with you, and we would love to help you find out where that next step is. And so if you would like to join with this church or find out what steps we are taking into the future, please come. You can contact me during the week. My information is on the front of your bulletin, and it's also on our website, DeLeonFUMC.org. Or you can come and share that with me right now as we stand and sing one more time.
And we'll see.
shared that song. I sang that hymn as a child in my church growing up. And I knew I was answering something. I did not know what I was signing up for, let me tell you. But God prepared me. God equipped me. God called me, as unlikely as I was. And I know that God has called you. That God has called each of us. Not necessarily into ordained ministry, but God has something for you. And I hear you. I know some of you are saying, yeah, I know, I did that already. Guess what? There's no such thing as retirement as a Christian. God is not done with you yet. God is not done with any of us. And I know God has lots for us to do together. And so I send you this week with the prayer and blessing that as you go, that you receive power to whatever ordinary or great degree is sufficient for the responsibility to which God has called you. Go in peace.